Okay, I'm going to tell you how I got this box ready. This is a paper mache box that I bought at Michael's. And it's one that's already covered with some kind of paper. This darker color here was all over the outside quite a bit. So how I prepared this box to paint was I mixed equal parts of clear gesso in with my black paint. Now there's three ways that you can prep this box. One is you can use just a regular gray household interior primer and put a couple of coats of that on here, and that should block any of that paint coming through, or any of that paper, the design on the paper coming through. Of course, I've painted with black, so it shouldn't come through black anyway, but if you're using a lighter color, you could use that. If you're painting black or even white, you could use the JW Undercover. It comes in black and white. This is like a primer, but it gives it a tooth, kind of like the gesso does. And I just mixed equal parts of gesso in. And I rolled mine on with a roller. You can brush it on. You know, I just prefer to put my base coats on with a roller. Besides it going faster, I like the little bit of tooth texture that it gives it. So those are three different ways that you can put your base coats on. Now, after I rolled on two coats with the gesso, but you can just mix it in with your first coat, and then your second coat can just be straight black. You don't have to have the gesso in with the second coat. So now we've got our box all ready to go. I am going to be painting four of these because they're going to be Christmas gifts. So I've got this one ready to go. I've got my circle drawn on here, and I just used this circle template, which I have a couple of different circle templates. I just came across this one the other day at Michael's, and so it has all different sizes of circles. It comes with two sheets, one very large circles, and then all the way down to this teeny tiny little dot of a circle here. So that's a good circle template that I like to use. And so now I've started my pattern on the top. And I want you to know that I am going to put this pattern on in stages. So right now I've got my peppermint sticks on here. Excuse me. And I traced my box shape, and then I drew my pattern on my paper here. So how I got my line so straight for my peppermints is when I traced it on, I put my T-square up here. I put my tracing paper underneath it, and then I just took my stylus and just went down the pattern lines for my straight edges on this. And then I just used, you know, my stylus and drew in the bottom edges. We are going to be painting this in steps. So the first thing that we are going to paint, I just wanted the peppermint shapes on there so I would know where they would be. The first thing that we're going to paint is the back pine needles that are in the back. Not the ones that are on top, but the ones that are in the back. And then we'll do the holly leaves that are in the back. Then we'll do the peppermint. Then we'll do the holly leaves and pine needles that are on top. Then we'll add the berries, which the berries I haven't drawn on my pattern yet because I'm not sure exactly where it is that I want to be putting them. So that's how we're going to be starting this pattern out in steps. So as you can see, I've only put on my peppermint shapes. So now I want to put on my pine needles. So I'm going to line my pattern back up on here. And it's okay if it's not exactly where I trace my peppermints. I just need a good idea of where I want my pine needles in the background to be. So I just cut a hole in the top and bottom of my pattern. I'm going to slide my transfer paper under here. And then I'm just going to draw a line right here. down a line right here, just where my pine needles will be. Okay. I'm going to move it down so I can get different sections. I'm just putting the ones on that are in the back. This one I think I might have come through over here a little bit. Okay, now this one is back over here. Got one. This one is back. That one's on top. That one's on top. And this one is back over here. Okay, so I've just basically put the lines where my pine needles are going to come out, and we'll start painting those on, and then we'll go in and add the pattern for the holly leaves, the ones that are in the back. These that are on top will be the ones that we add last, and that's how we're going to start painting it. So I'm going to get my paint all set up for my palette, get my camera adjusted a little bit different. It's not quite at the angle I would like for it to be at, and then we're going to get going on this project. All right, so we've got the pattern on, and we are going to get ready to start on this project. All right, so we're going to start on the pine needles here, and I am going to start with my base color of avocado. I'm going to use a 10-0 liner brush. It has the longer bristles. It's the one I like to use. All right, now to use a liner brush, you need to have your paint the consistency of ink. So I am dipping straight down into my water. I'm bringing the brush over to my paint with the water in it. I'm pulling the paint out and blending the water in it. I will have to go back several times. You can really see the water on my brush now. All right, I've got a good amount of paint pulled out there, so now I'm just going to continue to add water until I get it the consistency of ink. You don't want it too thin, because then it disappears down into your project, and if it's too thick, it will not flow off of the brush, and you need it to flow nicely. So I have a lot of paint and water in my brush, so I'm going to rinse it out, lay it on my paper towel, and get any excess water out and the water off the ferrule. Then I'm going to come right here and load the brush and pull it out and give it a little roll. Get that nice tip on the end of your brush. Okay, then we just want to come in here and just pick some pine needles that you want to start with. Try to keep you on camera here. And I'm going to pull out where that pine needle is going to go. And then I'm just going to start pulling strokes from that middle line right out here, all the way to the tip. And then we'll come and go along the other side. You want to stay up on the tip. Let the paint do the work, or the brush do the work. Let the paint just flow off. Okay, and we're going to come back with some other colors on top of that. This is just our first color here. Okay, we're going to do it on this side as well. So this one is going up this way. I'm going to do a couple and finish them out for you so you see how they're going to look. We just need to get all this background stuff done first so that we can lay our stuff in on top. Okay, I'm going to do one more over here. We'll come back and redefine that center line when we're done. Depending on the kind of pine tree that you got your little limbs off of, some have really long, pointy needles. Some have a little bit shorter needles. Okay, so we've got three started there. All right, our next color is going to be olive green. We are going to do it the exact same way. You know what? I think instead of olive green, I'm going to go to leaf green for my next color. So I'll keep my olive green on my palette. I'll start with my leaf green. You will be doing less of each color because we're building layers for the pine needles to give them depth. I don't know how well you can see that. It's kind of a bluish green, that leaf green is. It's a little bit brighter than that avocado. You can see it's brightening up right there. Now, if you're not painting on a black background, you could start your base, your first layer of on these pine needles with black green. Okay, one more. Need a little bit more water in my paint. And our final layer will be that olive green. So thin some of it down with the water. Clean your brush. And load it up. And we're going to do even less of this color. And this one you'll really see, so don't go overboard with it. If you wanted to just leave it with the two colors, the avocado, let's see, it was, yeah, straight avocado, and the leaf green, you could do that. If you didn't want to add this third color, you would not have to do that. I wanted just a little bit more brightness in there. Now I'm going to go back into my avocado and re-pull my stems down the center. Just clean it up there a little bit. All the way to the end. Just clean that up nicely. Okay, so we're going to go finish the rest of these pine needles. And this one here goes behind this right here. So you'll want to do them on this side and then go and do them on that side. And it's okay if you get into our peppermint stick right there, because we're going to come back and cover that up. You don't want to get a lot into it, but it's okay if you get a little bit into it. We will come back at the end and add a few pine needles coming up over and around things to make it all look really nice together. Okay, I've got all my background pine needles done. So now I want to start on the peppermints. And one thing that you can do if you want to make sure that your peppermints stay completely straight is to tape off right on that line on each side. So we've got this peppermint taped off. Then I'm going to take a makeup sponge. I'm going to use warm white. And I'm going to... I've got it. It's dry. So I'm going to dip a little bit of that paint on here. And then I'm just going to tap it here. Makeup sponges are not very absorbent. so it won't soak the paint up in there. So you're just kind of tapping it in, kind of working it and smoothing it out on the end of that sponge. And it will take a few layers of this. Now you've got to remember where the end of your peppermint stick is right there, okay? And not go past that end. So I'm going to go right up to here and tap this on. This is just a quick way to get it on here, to get the base color on. This is warm white. And we can get two coats on here very quickly. I'm going to go up to right about there. Okay, and then I'm going to take I've got a number 8 flat. I'm going to finish the ends out. Oops, water on my ferrule there. Let me get that off. I'll just finish the ends out. All of my lines there. And after I take the tape off, if my lines don't match up very well, I can adjust it then. But if I've got my tape right on that line, it should be okay. Something in my paint there. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and quickly tap on another coat. Plus, having a black or a solid color background, if for some reason I go past where I have tape, I can just touch that up real easy. And we will do this to all of our peppermint sticks. We will paint each one individually, let them dry, remove the tape as soon as you get done getting your base coat on, and then let them dry and tape off the next one. Okay, so I'm going to remove the tape here and see how we did. Pretty good. It's best if when you put your tape down, you fold one end of it under so that when you go to pull it off, it will come off much easier. So there we've got our first peppermint stick on here. I do notice that the bottom down here needs to be touched up, and my peppermint stick is not the exact same width all the way down. But we'll be putting other stuff on here, so it will be all right, I think. This peppermint that's on the front will also be painted in with warm white. So you'll just follow the circle here and put two or three coats of warm white on here. When you brush it on, it seems like it takes a little bit more coats than when you sponge it on. Not really sure why that is, but follow your circle the best you can and try not to get outside the lines. That way you won't be continually making your circle bigger and bigger and bigger. And I find that when I paint my base coats on, the best coverage I can get is to thin my paint down and use thinner coats. Because when I use too heavy of a coat the first time, then it just is thick and globby, and it's not very nice. And then when you go to paint your details on top of it, then you don't have, you know, a very good looking piece because your base coat was not done in a nice smooth manner. Okay, so I'm going to get this one dry and tape off and paint the others. Okay, I wanted to show you as I was painting this peppermint here, because this peppermint is behind. Now, you can have it on top. It doesn't have to be behind. That is definitely a personal preference there. You can adjust the pattern that way if you'd like to. But I am going to turn the sponge sideways here. So I'm just going up to that one. I don't want to go over it and add another coat of paint onto it. It probably would not hurt anything if you did, but I don't want to have that tape line going across the end of it. So if I pounce more onto it right there where the tape is, right here where the tape comes over it, then it will leave a little bit of a raised line there, and I don't want to have that. So I just wanted to give that little note to you, and we will continue on here. All right, I've got all mine done. I wanted to give you a couple little tips for sponging with your makeup sponge. It will splatter like any other sponge if you pounce too hard or you have too much paint on the end of it. So just be aware of that. You can always go back and touch up with your black if you do that. And then when you are done with it, I usually lay it just flat like that on my palette paper. And then when it dries, I will take my scissors and cut the end of it off, so that you can continue to use the makeup sponge until it gets down to a little bit of nothing. So these are a good investment to have, and they work very well for sponging on paint. So I went ahead and added some peppermints on the ends of my box here. I don't know if I'm going to add anything on the front here. I don't want the box to get too busy. So for now, that's all I'm going to add to it. So we want to start now by adding the stripes onto our peppermint. And we're going to do that with tomato red. And you're going to use a 2-round brush. Number 2 or number 3. My bottle is almost out of paint here. Alright, let's see what I've got here. Number 3, probably too big. I like the Winsor Newton rounds, but really it's whatever round that you prefer to use will be just fine. So let me zoom you in here. So always dampen your brush. Wake it up. Your brushes need to be conditioned to use them. So to do that, you get them full of water. You can hold it against the side of your water basin if you want and just let the bristles fill up with water, and then just go over and wipe the excess on your paper towel. Now I'm using tomato red. My paint is very thick. This bottle is getting down to the end and I think it might be getting a little bit old. So I'm going to thin my paint down just a little bit here because I definitely do not want to be using paint that is this thick. It is super thick. See how thick that is? It is some of the thickest paint ever. So I've thinned a little bit down right here. Okay. So you can go with the pattern and look and see, you know, transfer your stripes exactly how I have them on the pattern. Or you can just start painting and create your own little stripe design on here. So we're going to start with this one. I'm just going to lay my brush flat because these brushes, even though they are round, they act like a little flat brush. Now to me that stripe is not near big enough, fat enough I guess I should say. So I'm going to go beside it and add, make it a little fatter. Go all the way to the edge. Okay, so we're just going to create these little stripes all the way down this. We will probably come back next to these and add some green stripes. Now Now remember, this one lays on top of both of these. So we want to make sure that we remember that as we're painting these peppermints. I love painting peppermint sticks or candy canes, peppermint candies for Christmas. They are so much fun and really fairly easy to do, I think. I don't think you have to get your stripes perfect. I'm sure if you look at a peppermint stick or a candy cane, it's going to look perfect at first glance, but there's probably going to be a few imperfections in it. I don't like to make everything look so perfect, because nothing in nature is perfect. Now, if I'm building a piece of furniture, I do want it to be perfect, but when I'm painting, I don't have that concern. I just want it to be fun and stress-free. And if we try to go for perfection, I can see that my stripes got wider and wider as I went down. So the first two or three up there, I'm going to have to go back and fatten them up. Water in my paint. So let me go back up here and fatten these two up a little bit here. Maybe this one just a tiny bit. Alright, I think they're all looking pretty close to the same size. So we're going to do that with the other two. And this one, I have the stripes going this direction. So let's do this one. Now you can have a little bit of red here on this edge here. You can make these stripes closer together if you like. It's a little bit easier for me to pull the stripes this direction. So I may turn my box upside down when I paint the next peppermint stick. Making a mess of this here. Water in my brush. It's kind of dragging there. I'll try and keep these stripes a little bit closer to the same size. Okay, so we're going to have one that's going to be behind, so we'll see a little bit of it right here. Okay, so we can imagine one here, and this one coming down here. See it all the way over. Okay, one more water, pull some more paint out, thin it down. That sponging will give you just a little bit of texture. That really is going to depend mostly on paint you have on your sponge, so I have a little bit of texture going on here on mine. Alright, so we've got two that have got the red stripes on. I know this is the ugly stage when you're painting peppermint sticks. You know, you just look at them and you think, oh my goodness, what in the world? This is going to look just awful, but trust me, trust me, trust me. These are going to be fabulous peppermint sticks. I have got red paint up in my ferrule, so I have got to get that out, because if you leave paint in your ferrule, it will just ruin your brush. It will cause the bristles to splay out and not be a nice brush. And if you're buying good quality brushes, you want to be sure and make sure that you clean them well after each time that you paint. Alright, so I'm starting this third . This one, I'm making the stripes a little bit more narrow on it. More water. That one's a little bit dry. So we've got all of them with their initial stripes on them. Now we want to come back and add a little bit more to them. I'm going to put some green stripes on one of them. I think the one in the middle. I'm going to put green stripes on here right next to the red. Green, and a little bit with some water so it will flow nicely off of my brush. Oh, that was kind of a wiggly line there. I can straighten that out a little bit. These are just very thin lines. You're staying up on the very tip of this liner brush. Now, I think on this one, I want to paint a couple of thin red stripes. I'm going to go one, two, one, two. On the tip. Okay. And then trying to decide on the other one if I want extra stripes on it as well. I think I will do red stripes, one on each side. I can't really do it on each side because they're a lot closer together. So we'll just do one. Okay, so we've got our three peppermint sticks right there. So they're kind of still in their ugly stage. I'll shade them and give them a little bit more oomph here in a minute. I want to move around to our peppermint. So I'm going to show you how to do this one. And I may go over here and do another one over here because I want some to be green and some to be red. So I think this one right here I'm going to make red. So I'm going to continue to use my number one round. I'm going to put a little dot right in the center. Okay, you see that little bitty dot that I put in the center there? I'm going to try and keep this so you can see it fairly well on the camera. So I'm going to get some water and thin some of this paint down. Inky consistency. Now, when I do my peppermints, I like to curve them around like this. You can't even see that line. Let me make it a little bit darker and I can erase it. I like to curve them around. I've got quite the glare there, like that. But you can also just bring them straight out like that. Okay, so it's going to be a personal preference there how you would like to do that. Okay, so I'm going to make four. Something on the end of my brush there. I'm not sure what it was. Okay, so I'm going to make four. I'm just going to curve that around and then bring this one and curve it around. Put a new light bulb in my light and I think it is just causing a little bit of a glare here. Okay, so there's my first one and I flip it around and create one opposite of that. You can just do three, you know, break it up into thirds. Fourth one, I guess. Math is not my strong suit. That's why I paint. But my paint's dragging there. Okay, so that's how we do the initial part of that. Now I'm going to take my liner and my green paint. And you can do two coats of this red. And I'm going to put a green line. Oh, too much paint on my brush there. Right next to each one of these. Got some dried paint there. Something on the tip of my brush. I have to take a minute and clean this one. Because it is not working right. Okay, that was very sloppy. Because the tip of my brush was just really messed up. Let's see if I can. Okay, so I've got that one done. Now, over here, when I do this one, I think I will do it opposite of that. I'm going to do green for my wider parts. So I'm going to put a little dot in the middle. Now this is going to be a little bit trickier for me to do and stay on camera and balance my hand on the end of this box. Okay, there's the first one. Now when you make your thin lines beside these green ones, you can do red lines or you can do green. Depends on if you want your peppermint to be all green or if you want it to have the red on it as well. Okay. And you can make your little pinwheel things much darker than that if you prefer. Thin down a little bit more red paint here. This tomato red is a much thicker paint for some reason. Alright, I'm gonna just put a thin line next to all these. Okay, there's our green one. Alright, so that's what we're going to do to all the peppermints. So, I'm going to get them finished so we can shade all of our peppermints at the same time. Alright, we're going to start shading on all of our peppermints. Now, I tested one of my peppermints to see if I would like this color for the shading, and I think it's going to work out okay. So, for the red, now, these here I will probably shade with green, but for all the red ones I'm going to shade with Rookwood Red. Now the kind of brushes that I like to use for shading are these curved flats. And there's a 6, a 10, and a 12. They also come in a size 16. Let's see, there's the 10. Mine are starting to get a little worn looking, so I'm going to have to replace a few of them. So there's 6, 10, and 12. Here is 16, size 16. And I think I have one even bigger than that, but I'm not sure. I sell these on my website, but I'm not sure how big my sizes go on my website. But these are the brushes that I like to use for floating because I think they make your floats very soft. In tighter areas, you know, I would go for an angle brush, but I just love these brushes. They're really amazing brushes. They are Lowell Cornell curved flats. All right, so I'm going to wake this brush up. Okay, now I'll show you how I load for floating. Here is my palette. I have a little Mr. bottle. You can use for whatever. I got it in the travel section at Walmart, so. Now I spray water drops all along this side of my paper. So I will have various size water drops on there. And when I need water, I will pick it up on the curved part of my brush. Occasionally I may need paint or water in with the paint, so I will just, you know, touch it down like that and get some little drops of water. Now when I load, I stick the toe into the paint and then I just start making a little V. Now I've got way too much water. Can you see how watery that is right there? Way too much water. So I just touched my brush to my paper towel. Let the excess, all of that excess water get out. I go right back here where it was very wet because I just took all the water out of my brush. So I want to make sure that I got a little bit of water in my brush, so what I had right here where I was working it in was plenty. So I'm just going to work it in. I want to get it up the bristles a little bit. I don't really want to get it over, so I'm not going to push real hard because I don't want a wide float, but I want my float to carry. And how soft it is right there on your palette is how soft it's going to be when you go to paint. So if you feel like you have too much water still in your brush, just go touch the tip of it to the paper towel and get the excess water out of it. Now I've got way too much paint in my brush. I need to make this a little thinner. I want it to be a washy float. So I'm going to remove that and I'm going to wipe excess paint off of my brush and go pick up some water. So I'm just picking up some water now and just working. I wiped the paint off on my paper towel. Okay, I need just a little bit of paint on there. I want it to be very thin color, washy like this. Okay, now again, I have a lot of water in my brush, so I'm going to touch the water edge of my brush to the paper towel and let some of that excess water get out. Now I'll go try this again. Much better. I want that softness in my float right there. If I need to come back and darken it, then I can do that. But if I make it too dark to begin with, then you know, I can't take that paint off once it dries. So I would rather build it up gradually as opposed to one big dark float. Okay, so see, that's not quite as dark there as it is over here, but that's still wet, so I can't do anything about it. So I'm going to take my either your liner brush or your small round and dip into that Rookwood Red, and I'm going to touch it right here in the center. Just make a little center spot there. Now we're going to let that dry and then we're going to come back and add a highlight on there. So now I want to go on top and work on these bigger ones. So I'm going to pick up some more water. I want to get this paint a thin washy paint, but I want to keep it, you know, mostly on the toe. So we'll come right here and separate these two right here. And I'm not sure if I'm going to like the Rookwood Red. I really liked it on this one, but I might switch over to a cranberry wine. So that's still pretty wet. Let me remove that. So I just put some water across there, got it wet, and removed it. So let me get a different red. Let's see, cranberry wine. Sometimes I think cranberry wine is too on the pink side. So let me see. I prefer to have the Rookwood Red. The Country Red's going to be too bright. Let me see how I like the cranberry wine here. It's got just a touch more pink in it. I don't know. I think I'm going to stay with the Rookwood Red because I'm not liking that either. So this is how you can test your colors. It's best to test them on a practice piece and not the piece that you're painting. But this is how I design. So I just start painting and, you know, pick up some colors and see how they look. So let me zoom you in just a little bit. Not too much because I don't want you to get on camera where you can't see the hole. A little bit more paint, that's not quite enough. Okay, got it on this one a little bit, so I'm going to take the water edge and just clean that off. If find my mop brush. I always use a mop brush when I float. Rarely do I ever not use a mop brush. I know I'm going to have to come back and probably do this twice because I don't think that's quite dark enough. For a float. But now we're seeing which, you know, we can really see those pop up and one be on top of the other one. So let's go over here and do it here. Now I'm laying my brush flat. I'm giving gentle pressure and just kind of taking it along that edge. Don't feel like you have to get your float in one continuous motion. Over on that one a little bit too much, but I think when I am shade around it, it will be alright. Alright, so now we want to float around the whole peppermints sticks here. Okay, so I'm going to start with this one in the middle. Start at the top. I'm laying my brush flat. Coming down that edge. And I'm going to mop that in the water area. That will remove a little bit of that paint that got over a little bit too far and soften that float all at the same time. You only want to go into the paint like on the edge if you need to remove some, because if you mop in your paint, it will remove the paint. Laying my brush flat. You could probably go to a smaller flat brush or curved flat instead of using this 12. Which I might do because it's my float's coming over just a little bit farther than what I want it to come over. I want these peppermints to look kind of old-fashioned peppermints, but I don't want the shading to completely cover the entire peppermint. So I just put a little water in there, and now I'm mopping it, and that will remove any paint that got into the center of that. Now, to clean your mop brush, you go to a clean, wet place on your paper towel, and you get the excess paint out of it. Use your mop brushes dry. Then you go to a dry place, and you just get the water that got on the tip out of it, and you're good to go with your mop brush. Very easy to clean and maintain those brushes. All right, let's go down and do this other part of this peppermint. Okay, laying my brush flat. Around the curve there. I'm definitely going to have to float a second time with this. Okay. So there we have. This one's all shaded all the way down. Okay, you can see a huge difference between those. Okay, pick up water as you need it. Keep your paint soft and washy. Thin color of paint, because you can go back with a second coat, but if you get it too dark, you can't take it off once it's dry. Mopping in the water area. You put a little bit on the white edge that I didn't get covered up. Okay. So we've got one edge done on that one. Finish it up down here. I love painting peppermints. So much fun for the holidays. Alright. More paint, more water. Okay. I was up on the toe a little bit right there because that's a really tight area. Now I have my brush flat. Very gentle, easy pressure. Walking that along there. I'm going to mop, clean my mop brush, because because if you don't clean your mop brush with each one, then as you go to your next place where you need to clean it up, you're just going to be putting paint down because of the paint that's in your mop brush. When you go into the water, it will release the paint that's in your mop brush if you don't clean it. Okay, flat. Gentle pressure. Side of that one is done. We'll definitely come back and deepen. Flat, gentle pressure. Flat brush, gentle pressure. So we've got the first shading on those, and you can see a difference when you get things shaded and don't get them shaded, how they look. Let's do the floating on the green one, and the green that I based it with is what I'm going to float with. Let's see how that looks. I might have to go with black green. Have to go just a tiny bit darker. Let's try some avocado because black green might be too dark. Bottle's just about empty there. Can't get any paint out. Alright, I'm just going to mix it on my brush with that green that was already on there. And we'll see how this is going to look. Good. Okay, I'm going to take that paint. I'm going to dip into both paints with my brush. Put a dot right here in the center. Probably couldn't even see that. Probably wasn't even on camera. Just put a dot right in the middle. The green. Okay, we will have to come back and repeat that, I'm sure. Okay, I'm going to get the rest of them the first float on so we can come back and add the second float and the highlights. Okay, I'm starting my second floats here. Now, I made a change here. On my second float, on all my red ones, I did cranberry wine, and on my green one, I did just leaf green. So, I think that's going to look a little bit better. So, let's get the second float here. And I think where one lays on top of the other one, I am going to add a tiny bit, just a teeny tiny dot of lamp black to my cranberry wine so that I can just deepen that just a tiny bit. Now if you wanted to go all straight cranberry wine or all straight rookwood red for your shading, I don't think it's going to make much difference one way or the other. I just wanted to brighten a little bit, and the cranberry wine seemed to do that for me. Ooh, too far over on my brush, so I cleaned my brush off. I had paint more than halfway over on my brush. So if that happens, you're going to be just basically base coating. So it's best to just remove wash your brush out and start all over. Oops. Yeah, I got it way too far over right there. Clean my mop brush. It's a very important habit to get into, cleaning your mop brush after each use. I think I already did that one. So let me do the other side of this one. One more side, and then we're going to add a little, and when I say little, I mean little tiny dot of black to the cranberry wine or the rookwood red, either one. I'm going to do it to the cranberry wine since that's the last color that I floated these with. So I'm just going to go straight over. And I got just a tiny little bit of black on my brush. I'm going to go pick up my cranberry wine, work it in, see how it's making a much darker color there. So that's going to give me just a little bit deeper shading right here next to these. I could even add just a tiny bit more black in there. Make it a little bit richer. Yep, that looks much better. Tap that out. Right here. I think that really helped that a lot. Okay, now we're going to do a highlight on these. My mop brush here. Now the highlight is a very easy thing to do. I'm going to take some Snow White and I'm going to thin it to inky consistency. Now, when you thin your white, make sure that you go into clean water, because if you go into your dirty water or water that has any paint whatsoever, you're going to add that color right to your white color, right to your white paint. Any light colored paint that you need to thin down, you always want to go into your clean water. Okay? All right. So I wiped my brush out to get any excess water or paint that I had in it. Okay, so when we do these here, I'm going to touch my brush to my paper towel to get excess water out of it. We're just going to draw a line around each one of these. that's your highlight. You could put a little dot in the center as well if you wanted. That's not necessary, but completely up to you. Okay, you can just make a continuous circle if you want, but I like breaking it up a little bit like that. I think it makes it look a little bit more like the light is just catching it. Okay. So that's how we do the highlight on there. All right, now on these, we're just going to take a line straight down the center. Hopefully it will be a straight line. So you see my line was going a little crooked there. So I'm going to try and make it a little straighter and keep you on camera at the same time. Try and erase that first line I put on there. I'm just using a damp brush here, just very gently taking it onto that paint. Now I've got it damp, so I'm very, I cannot stress how gently I am erasing that with a white eraser. Very gently. Okay, so we've got a highlight on that one. So we'll put a highlight on this one. Down here. And then on this one as well. Ooh. A little paint on my brush. That could have been a bad deal if it had ran down my brush. It's just feather light touch here. Okay, so we've got our highlight on those. And just look how that makes those pop. That shading and the highlighting gives you the roundness and just makes those peppermint sticks just pop. I love painting on black for Christmas. Okay, so now we need to add the rest of our pattern here. We need to transfer our holly leaves and any of the pine needles that are on top, because we'll be painting the pine needles next. And then we'll come back in and paint our holly leaves. So let's get this lined up first. See, right now my lines are not matching, but that's okay. We just have to get it close. It doesn't have to be perfect. So I'm going to get the rest of this pattern transferred on so we can finish this up. Okay, I'm going to try it with the white graphite. I know up here it will be okay, but as I get down here in the candy cane, we'll see if we can see that or not. So I'm just going to transfer the shape of these. See how we're doing. And I can't quite see them. Let me get a darker piece of paper here. All of my graphite paper is pretty worn out. I might have to get a new piece. Got a little bit more. I don't usually like to use pieces quite this big, mostly because I can't see where my pattern is laying on it at. So I think I'm just going to cut this little square off right here. Use it. Pattern back on here. under, and let's see how this one's going to work out. Okay, I can see that one better. I don't know how well you can see it, but make sure that piece of tape is stuck right there. Coming off. My graphite paper is, and I'm going to push a little bit harder so that I can see my lines. I can always go back if I don't put any paint on them and erase them. Once you put paint on a graphite line, it's set in your piece and you can't get it out. So you want to make sure you cover the line with paint or paint just right up to it so that you can erase it after. Okay, looks like they did. All right, let me put my pine needle lines. I've got one here, one here. I've already painted that one in. I think those are the only two that are on top. I think everything else is behind. I'm going to need pine needle there, it looks like. One that comes across somewhere in there, I think. Alright, we'll see how that works out. See if I need to add any more to it here in a little bit. So we're going to do the pine needles the same way we did up there, starting with the avocado, then the leaf green, then a little bit of olive green, and then redraw your stem in there, and get that done, and then I'll make a decision on what color I would like to have the holly leaves. Alright, before we start painting in the holly leaves, we are going to add these pine needles that are on top. And I missed one that's behind over here, so I'll finish it as well. Now, it's a different day for painting for me, and I never paint the same way two days in a row, it seems like. So, we'll see if I can get this to look similar. So, I'm not going to worry about my holly leaf that I've drawn in there. I'm just going to go right over this and start adding some pine needles. This one is going to lay top of this peppermint. And the reason that I like to go over my pattern that I've drawn on here, I can come back and add the pattern back on, because then you don't have like start and stop places where you tried to go behind something. So it's easier if you can paint the things in back first and then transfer steps of your pattern as you need to. And then this one, look at my pattern. It goes through here. Didn't quite draw my line in the same place, but that's no problem. It's all in the general vicinity here. And I'm thinking I might come back and add some filler flowers. I can come back in, and anything that I don't get paint on right there on that mark, I can erase, so I'm not worried about going over it with the paint. Generally, I would be, because once you go over it with paint, it's set in there and you can't do anything about it. Okay, so then this one is behind here. So I have to try and keep this off of my... Let me find my straight palette. Try and keep it off of my peppermint here. So I'm going to put my palette knife right there. I don't know how well that's going to work because it might make my marks stop too bluntly. That worked out pretty good. And then over here, we'll do the end of this one. Okay, now while I have this color on my brush, I've drawn some holly leaf vine things here. So I'm going to continue with this 10-0 round brush and the avocado. And I'm just going to create my vine. Right along here. Okay, now I've got my leaves coming off, and you can just have some stray little viney things coming off of this. It doesn't have to be, you know, something that's perfect. So just add some detail where you want it. Okay, we'll come back and take care of the leaves when we do our leaves, and then see what other detail we might want to add to that vine. I don't want the vine to be too distracting. I didn't want this piece to get too busy, but I felt like it needed something else right there, so let's see how that goes. We'll put some berries on there too, like we are going to do on this one. Okay, our next color is leaf green, so let's get these layered in here. I really like this leaf green color because it's got just a tint of blue in it, so I just think it's a beautiful color. Stay up on your tip. Cut your paint thin to inky consistency. Oh, I lost my... went completely off the line there. But that's okay. Alright, let's put some of this over here. A little bit back here. Okay, and our last color, which we don't need a whole lot of, is the olive green. I like to use this a little sparingly on here because I don't want it to be too bright. I want my pine to stay a little on the darker side, not the bright side. Should erase that line because I keep wanting to paint to it. Just a couple here, not too much because it's in the shadows. A little bit up there. Okay, then we want to go back with our avocado and redo that center line. Just clean everything up there. Now, we're going to base our holly leaves in with, I originally had picked mistletoe, and then leaf green is what I put on my pine here. So, I think I'm going to go with leaf green. Mistletoe will probably be a color that I don't use at all. So I've already got leaf green on my palette here. I'm going to go with a little bit bigger round brush to fill these in. You can use a flat brush or a filbert, whatever you prefer. This is a 3-round. Most of my round brushes are Winsor Newton brushes. I just really like the way that the bristles react on these brushes, because you can make them flat, a flat brush or a round brush, and they have such a good spring in them to bounce back to whatever shape that you need it to be. So we're just going to go right over our pine. Okay, we're going to base all of them with this color. Even the little ones over here, we're going to base with this color. Okay, so all of our holly leaves are going to be based with the leaf green. So let's get that done. We'll come back and work on those. Okay, my paint is dry, so I'm just going to go in and erase any of my graphite lines that are still showing. Now we're going to get ready for some fun stuff. Okay, so I'm just going to draw in my veins on these. You don't have to do this. I'm just doing it for your benefit so you can see where I'll be going with this. I will do the same to the ones on the front, but I'm just going to show you how to work on these for now. Okay, we want to start by adding some shading on these, and we're going to use black green. I'm going to start with my 12 curve flat. I'm going to get all three sizes out because I will eventually use all three sizes. So I'll have them right here handy to get. Alright, let me wake this brush up. Okay, I'm going to load it like I showed you before. Sprayed my palette paper with water. You can see it all standing on there. I pick up the water on the curved edge of the brush. Okay, the paint on the toe. And I generally start out right here, just creating a little V. I'm pushing it that way and also kind of pushing it a little flat. I want the paint to get up the bristles. They don't necessarily have to come across very far, but I want it to get up into the bristles a little bit so that my float will carry just a little bit farther. Okay, I've got a nice little gradation of color here. I still got a lot of water in my brush. So we're just going to pick a leaf. So like this leaf right here lays on top of that one, and the same with this one. It kind of lays on top of that one. I think those are the only ones that lay on top of each other. So I'm going to be up on the toe right here, because this is a little tight area next to that peppermint. And then as I come around, I'm going to lay my brush flat, come around this one. I've got just a little bit too much water in my brush, so I went and laid it on my paper towel, picked up a tiny bit more paint. There we go, much better. You want to use soft pressure, and if you're in an area where you can lay your brush flat, you want to lay it flat. And I just gently mopped that. This is a much bigger brush. You'll probably want to stay with a 10. I'm using a 12 here. It's very large for some of these areas. But I'm used to working with a larger brush. I think if you can learn to work with a bigger brush, then you're going to get more control and better results, I think. Just mop that. Okay, I'm going to stay with this bigger brush for just a little bit. Because on these bigger holly leaves, I want to float some shading at the base of them. And I think I'll just come down this edge a little bit. more water on my brush than I need to have, but I'll come back and float this a second time, because with so much water, when I went to turn the corner, it just removed the paint right there, and you cannot go over a wet float because it just removes the paint. Okay, so let's do this one. I need just a tad bit more water. I'm trying to see where my shape goes here. So I'm just going to put a little bit there. I'm going to mop it. I need to clean my mop brush. You should clean it quite frequently so that you're not transferring the paint from your mop brush onto your project somewhere else. Still have this 12 flat. I'm going to keep it for just a little bit longer, and then I'm going to switch over for some of these smaller leaves. I'm just kind of walking that out. Walking it. Okay, I'm gonna see if I can fix that hole I dug in that one. More paint. Mopped that to soften it. A little bit of a hard line there. Okay, I'm going to go to my smaller brush so I can shade some of these other ones. I'm down to a 10. Wake it up. Load it the exact same way. So I'm going to start with this one here. I'll come back in a little bit when that dries and add some more in there. Now, if you notice, I just went right over my graphite line that I put on there. And it erased it. That's the one good thing about using a dressmaker's pencil for drawing some of your lines in, because once you paint over it, get it with paint or with water, either one, it just removes it, so you don't have to worry about it being set in your paint. Lay my brush flat, soft pressure. More here. Hope I'm keeping you on camera. Mop that. Clean my mop brush. Okay, so we've got a first highlight there. I'm going to stay with this 10 curved flat. Now you could go to a angle brush. If you feel much more comfortable using an angle brush, then you can do that. I'm going to start painting in some of the veins. So I'm going to paint it on this side. Just down the center. Curve it as, you know, follow the shape of your leaf there. Brush flat as I go along that. Now here, because it's right next to that peppermint, I'm going to be up on the toe a little bit, and then as I come out, I'm going to flatten my brush out. I needed a little bit more paint and water on my brush there. It's kind of draggy, but I just kept kind of working at it and worked it out. Need paint, not near enough paint there. I'm not really sure how much of a focal point I want these leaves to be. My main focal point is the peppermint. So that's going to determine how much detail I put on these leaves. When I touch with my finger, I'm just softening it the same way that I would if I was using a mop brush. Just, you know, kind of tapping it and smooths it and keeps it from having any hard lines. Let's see, what do we got left? Got this one. Probably didn't have you on camera for any of that, and I'm sorry. I've got it zoomed in a little bit so that you can be closer, but I have a bad habit of getting off camera when I do that, so I need to look up and make sure I'm on camera a little bit more often. One should have been technically going the opposite direction, but that's okay. I should have had the shaded part on the opposite side. Okay, did we get them all? I think we have them all. Now, I'm not sure. I think I'll just leave it at that, but with most holly leaves, you would have, erase these graphite lines here. A little distracting for me. You would have other veins coming off, like, into the points. Okay? So, I'm not sure if I want to do that or not. I think, for now, I'll leave it off. I want to go ahead and highlight on these. I'm going to highlight with olive green. Some fresh paint out here. Okay. I'm going to stay with the tin curve flat. Water on my ferrule. Let me wipe that off. You have water on your ferrule, it's going to eventually run down onto your project and just make a big old puddle. So you want to try not to have any water on your ferrule. Alright, so I'm going to start up here with this one. Laying my brush flat. Soft pressure. Just walk it out a little bit. Very gently tap it with a mop brush. Going to do this to all of our holly. That holly leaf is shaped a little bit weird, but it'll still work. nothing is perfect in nature. So we don't want to try and be perfect here. My brush flat, very soft pressure. My paint is very wet. It's not dry, so if your paint, if you're dry, then you either need to add water or paint to your brush, or add a little bit of water into your paint to make your paint a little more softer as you paint. Thicker and drier your paint is, the harder it is to paint with it. So. My brush is a little dry there. I don't know how well you can see. It's very draggy right there. So I'm going to go pick up a drop of water and just blend that into my brush. I picked it up on the paint side and then just blended it in. I think I'm gonna have to tilt this up a little bit so I quit pulling it away from where you can see. Water and paint both on my brush. Soft pressure, brush is flat. Come around the corner, it's still flat. Still soft pressure. And then I can go back and just walk that out just a little bit. Camera here. Flat, very dry. More water. I picked up water on the paint side. Flat. Yeah, we're going to come back and add a little bit more highlight in these areas that still, I don't necessarily want my holly to look like it's just cut in half, so. Smaller ones, I'll be up on the tip of the brush just a little bit more. I could go to my smaller curved flat. I want you to use the brush that you're most comfortable using. If you have developed a liking for angle brushes, and I use them occasionally, but for the most part I use these curved flats. And occasionally I will shade with just a flat brush. So it kind of depends on the project and which brush I'm going to grab in the moment. A couple more. I'm going to be up on the tip here because it's a little bitty leaf. This one up here. Okay, I think we've got all of them floated with a first and second shading and highlighting. So now I need a little more definition in my vein down the center. So I'm going to take my liner brush and thin some inky black and pull a little bit darker vein up in there. Water in my paint. You want it to be like ink. You want it to just very easily flow off of the tip of that brush. So it's not got any paint because it didn't want to flow. Didn't want to come off, period. And this is the same way that you'll paint the ones that are on the front side if you're doing a box like this. Okay, now I want to take my olive green with the same brush, thin it down to inky consistency. And I want to create a highlight on the, beside this vein. Doesn't have to go the full length. You can come back and intensify the highlight on the leaves. I think I'm going to add just a touch brighter highlight, and I may shade a few of these a little bit more. I think with my highlight I want to add a little bit of warm white in with the olive green, just a tiny little dot. So. I am going to pick up the olive green on my toe and a tiny bit of white, maybe two tiny bits of white. Say it's pretty close to equal amounts, two green to one white maybe. I've got a little bit lighter green. I think it needs to be a little lighter. So we'll call it equal amounts of olive green and white. And I just want to put this, too much paint on my brush there, not every place, but just in some key places, kind of will help keep your eye flowing. Just a touch more white to that. Okay, I think one more needs it, this one here. It's kind of a little draggy. Okay, I'm going to go back into my black green, and I'm going to deepen a few of the shaded areas. Right down here. Too much water, so I just went and wiped it off. Be very dark next to this one. And this one. A bit darker here. Thank you. Okay, let me zoom out just a little bit so you can see the whole thing a little bit easier. See right here, I got my green over into my peppermint. See if I can remove that. I just dampened that with some water. Now I'm very, very gently rubbing with a white eraser. Just trying to get the green off of the red there. You don't want to rub too hard because you will take the paint all the way down to the primer or base coat that you started with. So, if all else fails and you don't think that you can do that, then we'll go into our red, tomato red. And I will just touch that up along that edge. Check for any other places I need to do that too. I think that's the only one that was behind that's maybe causing some problem there. Oop. No white there. Erase that with some water. Alright, while I have this red, I am going to put some of it on my leaves. So you just pick some random places to wash some in. Because that's really all I'm doing is just got a little wash on my brush. That's too hard of a line right there. I don't like that. I want it to come out into the leaf a little bit more. So I just walked it down. Very gently tapped that. Then just pick and choose. I'm running out of water here. I'm going to spray some more. Okay, so I think this one down here. Just put some along that center vein. Tap. I tapped right on the paint because I wanted to remove a little bit of it. Be adding berries in here, so we don't want tons of red. This can have some reflective red on it. And this other little one here, I think. Not really sure where I'm going to put the berries yet, but I think one more of those big ones might need some. Trying to get the eye traveling down. So, where do I want to put it? Where? Let me look at it. I think on this one. Tap, tap, tap very gently. I think one over here might need it. Okay, very gently. Tap, tap, tap. Okay. I think that's got the eye moving a little bit. We'll get our berries on and see. if we need to do more. Now you'll do the holly leaves over here the exact same way that we did those, but you'll use a much smaller brush, like a 6 curve flat or a 1/4 inch angle. Whatever will be most comfortable for you to use, or a favorite brush that you like to use. So now I'm just going to go in here and figure out where I want to put my berries. I know I want some berries here. So put 3 there. And I think 1 here. And I'll put maybe 1 hiding back here. A couple over here. Just want them in random places. See, I'm gonna put a couple here. 1 down here. Let's see, let's put maybe 1 there. And a couple in here, I think. We'll get those painted in and see how those look. All right, before I paint the berries in, I want to shade a little bit on top of these evergreens behind all of the leaf sections where they lay on top of another. Just add 1 more layer of depth on here. So we're going to do that with black green. Oh, I can't even talk. And we're going to be floating this. Just going to come in here and add a little bit of depth around some of this stuff, and that really pushes those pine needles to the back. Now I've already drawn in my berry circle here, but I'm just going to go right over it because I can draw it back on. So every one of these will get . And this is also how you can clean up a few edges on things that you may not like. Just straight black green. I might add just a little bit more in here, give this a little bit more depth. You want everything that is behind to really look like it is behind. Okay, so can you see how the ones on that side kind of look set in there? And these still look like they're kind of just hanging on top. There's really no uniformity to it yet. So I'm going to go and get the rest of these shaded behind so we can get our berries painted on. Okay, we want to, also want to add a little bit of cranberry wine shading, like behind these that are laying over the so that they're just kind of not floating in air as well. I've got a pretty washy little float here because I don't want it to be too dark too quick. So if I need to come back and add another float on here, I can. So anywhere it looks like they lay over. Now we're going to base our berries in. All right, before we move on to the berries, I need to get these leaves on the front done. So I have got a 6 curved flat, and I'm just kind of gently tapping in a little float on the lower parts of these leaves at the base. back and add highlighting. We'll probably put a little vein down the middle. Then we'll need to pull our stems into our leaves. I'm using almost straight paint. I've got just a little bit of water in my brush because these are so small. I don't feel like I have to get as detailed with them. Okay, so there we've got our shading on. And, you know, like I said, if you don't use the curved flats, you can go to a quarter or an eighth inch angle. Okay, we're going to highlight it with the olive green like we did on the other ones. So we'll do top edges. Try to keep our points good points. Do this all the way across to all of them. And then we may come back and brighten that highlight just a little bit. They're all going to be done the same. So I'm going to show you a couple more and then I'm going to go finish this first highlight. This is almost straight paint with a little bit of water. It's not thinned down too much. Okay, I want to add just a final little highlight on these. And because these are so small, I'm just going to use a liner brush. And I'm just going to take some white and add a tiny little bit of olive green to it. And I'm just going to line along the edge. Get you on camera so you can see there. Just lining where I put my highlight, just adding a little extra bright spot with the line. Hopefully it won't fade down in there too far. I think that's going to look pretty good. Okay, we want to add a vein in the middle, and we'll do that with some inky black green. A little bit thin down here. We will also add some berries onto here. So we're just going to pull this right up into that. I think I might add a touch of... Well, I don't know. It needs to have a little bit brighter base down here. So I added some leaf green. So I've got leaf green with just a touch of black green. I think that's going to show up a little bit better. Alright, so we'll get all these finished out. I'll redo this one here. Just drop my paint, my brush in the paint. Okay, I've got all my leaves done here and I've drawn some berries along to put in there as well. So we want to get started basing the berries. So we are going to base them in. I'm just going to use a number one round and we're just going to base them in with cad red. So wherever you want your berries, just put those in. And it will take two coats get our first coat in, and then we'll go back and erase our graphite lines so they won't be so distracting. Now, if you are not comfortable with painting little circles like this, they do make these easy dot tools that you can purchase. I'm sure you can get them at Artist Club or Creative Arts Lifestyle sells them. You know, Hofcraft, all those places probably sell these, and they come with a set of two, all different size, that it's got, you know, 8 different sizes of dots that you can make. So if you're not somebody who likes to do circles, then you could get one of those. And they probably even make little stencils that make different size dots, I don't know. So that's another option if you can find one of those. It's all about making the painting fun. If it's stressful, you're not going to have fun and be relaxed. It should be a relaxing time. Okay, so we've got our first coats on. Really changes the piece. Each layer that you put on, it makes it look so much different. All right, let's get these on over here. And I just drew berries along here at random. So some of them I'll have to come back and add some stems, because some of them I drew in didn't even have a stem to attach to, so like this one here. Okay, so we've got our first layer on all of our berries. So now we want to go in and erase our graphite lines. Some of these aren't quite dry yet. I better let those dry just a little bit more. I'm going to put in a vein over here real quick for this one. I think it was the only one that wasn't attached. Some of the ones I can see are dry. That one there's not dry yet. There's that one on the end, not quite dry, so get all my eraser stuff off of here. I'm just going to let that one dry. That one on kind of thick. It's still not dry. Okay, so we've got our first layer. Let's go ahead and go back and put our second layer on. one's kind of underneath that leaf there. Okay, I don't think I missed any there. So let me go over to the edge. Quick second coat on these. I also need to go in and put some tints on these leaves. I'm going to wait till I get the berries done. Do that. Okay. All second coats are on, so we need to get these good and dry before we move on with our next step here. Okay, I want these berries to remain a little bit on the brighter side. So I've decided I'm going to float tomato red on the bottoms. Now this one here is underneath this leaf, so we'll go along that edge of it. I am going to be painting these berries a completely different color than I've ever painted any of my other berries. So we'll see how this works out. So tomato red shading. We based them in with cat red. Now tomato red won't be super dark on this cat red, but I'm hoping it will be just the right pop that I need. Probably will have to do it a couple times because I'm not seeing it too much this first time. I think when we get our highlight on here, it's going to be show up much better. I know I'm going to have to repeat that. And I don't really want to add cranberry wine to it, but I think I'm going to have to because that tomato red just did not give my berries enough depth. So I am going to dip into my tomato red and dip into my cranberry wine and just mix them together there. Kind of a color in between. I think I need a little bit more. My cranberry wine's starting to dry up there. A little bit more cranberry wine. And when you're floating something this small, you want to keep that float as tight on the toe as you can. You don't want it to take over. I think it would be alright too if you just wanted to go straight cranberry wine for the second float. Or if you just wanted to put cranberry wine just period, you know, without doing the tomato red. I just want to kind of set up a base for a different berry, so I am experimenting here. The one great thing is it's just paint. So if I end up not liking it, I can just paint right over it. I got them all with the berry wine there. So now for my highlight on these, I am going to use, I'm going to try bright orange. And see how I like that on here. And that just fades way too far down in there. So let me go with melon. Try it for a highlight. I really wanted some orange on here, but let me try some tangelo. Just experimenting all the way around with you guys. I'm gonna see how this orange looks. I think it's just not quite bright enough. I don't know, that kind of looks good. Maybe I just didn't have enough paint on my brush there. Okay, we're going to go with tangelo orange because I want some orange in these berries. I don't want them to blend in so much with the peppermints. So it's just a pretty straight paint. No thinning it down. Now if you're doing a smaller project, you can use just a round brush and line the edges. And this is a completely different color than I've ever tried on my berries before. So I think I'm really liking that orange on there. I think I will go, let me see about one more time with the cranberry wine. Yeah, we'll just do that. I think in my instructions I will type it up to where you just float with cranberry wine, do the shading with cranberry wine, and repeat it twice. I repeat all my shading and floating when I do it because I think the first one gets your float where you want it, but it may not be as good as you want it. And the second one just gives it that finished look. And I know this is three times that I've floated these, but that's because I experimented a little bit, so that's a little bit of an exception. Okay, I want to put the orange on there one more time. Brighten that up. Just straight paint on the toe of my brush. Even though these are small, I'm still trying as best I can to lay the brush flat when I float. which ones I did here. It's always best if you can start at the top and work your way down. Not like I do, start in the middle. That orange on those berries. And I'm going to add a final little dot highlight with my liner brush. And I'm going to take the Tangelo orange and mix a little white to it. And I'll just go in here and dot it. I don't want straight white because that will just be too bright, and you don't have to do them all if you don't want to. Just, you know, hit and miss kind of thing. And we add that extra little sparkle onto those. Okay, I want to put some of this orange in my leaves so that it kind of brings them together here. And I think, let me just try something. Another experiment here. I think I'm going to thin some down, inky consistency. And see how it looks in some of my I think I'll put some of this in my pine needles. Just carry that orange around. That orange is showing up for you in there. I have to make it a little bit darker. It's not a lot, just a stroke here or there. Touching back with my finger to soften it and make it not quite so bright. So I did not thin this too much so that you could see it more on camera. But I like that little touch of orange in there. Those pine needles. That really brings it all together. Okay, so now we need to finish these up. And these are much smaller berries. Erase this grab outline over here now. So I am going to just use my liner brush. I'm going to show you how to do this with a liner brush. So we're going to go do cranberry wine. And we're just going to, and you could still do an ankle brush or curve flat, you know, if you prefer to stay that way. That's perfectly fine. I just wanted to show you. I'll just stay on these top ones so I don't have to flip this around. So I'm just lining along the bottom with this round. This is a number one round. Whatever small round you have will work fine. Oop, got that just a tad thick there. And we'll come back with the Tangelo and do the tops. Okay, I just did the berries on the top. I'll come back and do the bottom ones here in a minute. I'll do them off camera so I don't have to be turning the box so much. just putting the orange on the top. Paint all over my finger here. Clean that off just a bit. So then you can decide on these smaller berries, they don't need as much detail as the ones above on the lid. But you still want them to look really nice. So you can decide if you want to repeat all of your shading and highlighting on these. I think I'll definitely go one more time with the cranberry wine. Okay, I've got all my shading and highlighting on my berries. So I'm going to do that final little highlight where I take some white on my liner brush and a tiny little dot of Tangelo orange and mix it in there. And I'll just come back and add a little dot. Try to make it a little dot. And I'm not going to do every one. I'm just going to pick a few out of here. Okay, so we've got our little highlights on there. Okay, now I want to add a little bit of this Tangelo orange to my leaves on here. Like I did with the red when I did the leaves up here where I added touches of the red here and there. On these leaves I want to add a little touch of orange. So I'm just going to pick and choose some places on some of these leaves. Let me see if I like that orange. I wanted to carry the orange, but I think I'm going to have to stick with the red. Because I think the orange is just not looking how I want it to look. So let me put out some tomato red here. You could even go with cranberry wine if you wanted to put that color on your leaves, just as long as it's one of the colors in our palette. I wanted the orange because I wanted it somewhere else down in here, but instead of just on the berries. It's just a random thing. I don't know how well that's showing up on the camera there. Let me make it just a little bit darker for camera's sake. I think if I'd have done the orange twice, it would have been okay. Gotten a little bit darker. I need to put some veins in these over here. They don't have any veins in them. This is just straight paint that I'm floating here. I haven't thinned it down like I normally do. Okay, let me get a couple of veins in here that I missed. Black green. Ooh, way too bright. Take some of the paint off of my brush here. There we go. We want these nice little thin lines like this. We don't want the big fat lines. So you gotta really stay up on the tip and have your paint the consistency of ink. Okay. Alright, we've just got a couple more things to do on here before we're done. Let me put some orange in this little... Whoa! Table just dropped down. Must not have had it locked in place good. So I'll put a little bit of that in that one. It didn't have any in it. Okay. Now, there's two things that I want to do. One is going to be an experiment. First thing I want to do is I want to put some glamour dust on here. I'm going to put it on this small peppermint first to see how I'm going to like it. This is just the Ice Crystal Glamour Dust. So it is a clear glitter paint, so it will not change the color whatsoever of your project. So I want to put this on the red. I don't know how well this is going to show up on camera. Some sparkly Christmassy stuff on here. You can see a little bit of that. I think on this edge piece, I'm going to put it on the berries. Just using a round brush and dotting it on there. This will not change the color of our berries. It won't take away from the shading or the highlighting. It's just going to give them some sparkle when it dries. And I'm going to go to the side, the candies that I put on the side of the box. Over here. And let's see. I think that I am going to glamour dust the whole candy here. Switch over to my three round. Oops. Let's see if I can keep you on camera. I'm just going to put it over the whole candy. On the ones on the end. The ones on the front, I just put it on the red. You can change this up if you paint this design and you want to put it just on the green areas or just on the white areas. It's however you want to do it. It's your piece. Be creative. I love when people paint my patterns and then are creative and add things. Alright, see if I can get any of that glitter for you to see. A little bit of it there, you can see. Let me go around to this end. I don't want to get outside the lines because I don't want it in my black. I can come back with my black and anything I got over in the background. Like I got some green over in the background right there. I can touch that up, clean up all my edges. That's the good thing about having a black background or a solid color background. I can clean those edges up. A lot on those berries there, so they've got a little bit of drying time to do yet. I wasn't sure if I wanted to put it on the peppermint, on the stripes on the peppermint, or the berries on here, so I think I'm going to stick with the berries because I like that idea. And you could also use your decoupage medium, your decoupage glue stuff, and put some of that on here, and then sprinkle some glamour dust or a clear, fine, really fine, ultra fine glitter on here, and that would give it a little more raised stuff. And if you're going to do that, if you're going to use glitter, I would recommend sealing, you know, varnishing first, and then coming back and adding that on top, and then just lightly misting it. Oh, I just stuck my finger in it over here. Kind of figured I was going to do that. Let me take a damp brush so I can clean that up where I just smeared it with my finger. Okay, let's get this dry so I can put a second coat on it, because I think Glamour Dust needs a second coat. So we're just going to use our little portable battery-powered fan, which I have these on my website. $1.50. Just can't hardly beat that for a quiet fan that you can take to class and dry your stuff quickly. Could use this pattern on a gift bag, just about anything. You know, if you do go to a Michael's and get a box like this, one of these paper mache box that has a magnetic closure, and paint it up, then you could fill it with candy, you could fill it with lotions, you could fill it with a couple of hand-painted ornaments. Just a fun little project to paint up for somebody. Got a little thick on my berry, so I want to make sure that it's dry enough that when I add the second coat, it doesn't lift my first coat off. So I'm going to put a little bit more out of my palette. I love the Glamour Dust, and it comes in all different colors. I originally was going to use like the red on the stripes. I had a green I thought about using on the leaves, but I didn't want to overpower the piece with so much glitter. So I settled on just using the clear, because the tinted ones will add color to your project, which they are very, very fun to use. Again. Just using a 3-round. Just dip it right into that Glamour Dust paint and get a nice little bit on my brush there so I can can see my brush is pretty full, so then I can lay it flat on there and then just spread it out. You can put as many layers or as few layers on this as you want. I just like to keep piling on the sparkle. Keep my fingers out of those other sides. All right, let's finish another coat on here. Now I was thinking about adding some white filler flowers on here, just to give it a little more Christmassy look. So I want to get this glamour dust completely dry before I test one of those on here, see if I'm going to like it. So let me go get this dry and then we'll come back and see how that's going to look. Okay, I want to try and add some little filler flowers on here, but I'm going to show you on a piece of scrap paper how I painted these two right here. I've used two completely different brushes, a flat brush and a filbert brush. This one's an 8 and a 4. You could definitely use a smaller flat brush. And how I have loaded them to get this particular flower, I've got quite a bit of water in my brush because of the paper here, but I just put a little bit on the corner of on one toe there, and I just kind of worked it in. And then I just laid it. I'm going to make a shape like this. So where I put the brush right here, this part of the brush will not move. Only the outer part of the brush will go down, go around. Bit more water because I'm sure my brush is dry by now. Okay, so I'm laying it right here. This is the edge with no paint on it, just water. So I'm pushing out, going around, and coming back down. This edge stayed right here in this area. I did not twist my brush. Okay, so I'm gonna make a V to show you where I'm going from. So I'm going from there, pushing out, and then coming back up on the bristles like that to create that little petal. Now with the filbert brush, I'm just gonna put a little bit of paint on the tip of the brush and work that in just a little bit. And then with it, you're just gonna lay the brush down and pull it up like this and stroke in 5 petals like that. Those are what we call little filler flowers. So I'm going to see how I'm going to like this on here. If I don't like it, I can quickly wipe it off. So I'm going to use the little filbert and see if I'm going to like some little filler flowers in here. And you can come back and dot the centers when you're done. I want to make sure this paint stays fairly transparent. I don't want it to... So this one up here, I'm going to do just 3 little petals on that one. And you can even go up on the edge of it and do them, make them a little bit, it won't make them as fat if you do it that way. I like them to be a little bit more fat, I think. So I want to keep this really light. These are just filler flowers. I don't want them to take over. Just kind of a little touching and dragging, because you just have a little paint on the very toe of it. That one's got a little bit more paint than I want, so I just went and wiped it off. I want my paint to remain a little more on the thin side. Now I want to come back and on some of these I want to add, just some smaller flowers around it. So I'm just touching down very easily, adding a couple of strokes in there. Nothing major. here. A couple little ones there. I think I will put one here in the middle. More paint for this one. I don't really want to cover up my berry, so I'm going to take it off of my berry so the flower looks like it's behind. Definitely need more water in my brush. So I went and got water, and then I wiped out the paint that I had on my brush. I don't want flowers to look like they're just hanging out on their own. Oop, definitely need water. Light. Almost faded in there. Okay, let's see. I think this one here might make a bigger flower. And then maybe put a small one peeking out over there. Okay, let me look at this a little bit at a distance. I don't want to overtake it. I see where I could use a couple more here. So I'm going to get more water and load just the tip of my brush. I think right in here. And I'm just doing a little touchdown. It's not a big movement at all. One peeking out from under here. Supposed to be just a touch darker. Okay. Those little filler flowers. So let's see if we want to dot the center with anything. Usually with filler flowers, I don't worry too much about it. I think I'll just take a dot of pure white and dot in the center of them. I don't want them to pop out too much, so anywhere where you think the center might be showing. A little bit big on that one. Keep them as tiny as you can. Okay, now I've got to decide if I want to put some filler flowers over here on the side or not. I don't want it to get too busy, is my thing, but I think I'll take my three round. You can make the filler flowers with a round brush as well. You just load it the same as the filbert with just a tiny bit of paint on your brush. Plenty of water. I think I might just put a few in here. You do not have to make these perfect. They can have 5 petals, they can have 3. I've done a couple with 4. You don't them as big or as little as you want here. Just basically little dabs. Okay, I think I'm gonna too much paint on my brush, I could tell. I want them to still remain fairly light. I don't want them to take over too much. I am literally just making dots. Let me go back and make this one a little bit better. Just making 5 little dots on here. Nothing spectacular in any way. Pretty good. Got my sparkle on my berries, my filler flowers. I think it's looking pretty good. I might just call this a done project. Okay, time to write up the instructions. Thanks for painting with me.